Thank you, Sam. It is a pleasure to be here. I wish I was on the other side of the Atlantic right now, but I'll take the comfort of my office for the time being, for sure. Jeff's going to be a hard act to follow. I mean, creator of the OWASP top 10. I mean, how can you follow that? But I'm going to be talking a little bit about CycloneDX today and Dependency Track today. It's funny because I've given a lot of talks on CycloneDX. I've also given a lot of talks on Dependency Track. I've never actually put these two talks together. So this is a first. We'll see how it goes. let me go ahead and share my screen here. Let's see. And let's see if this works. All right, very good. So with that, this is a little bit about me. I build stuff, I break stuff, I build stuff to protect stuff. I get paid for at service now, and we're hiring like most security organizations, so DM me. I'm not going to go over what is an SBOM. I think Jeff did a very good job at doing that. If you want to get some more executive level basics, however, maybe convince your management that this is something you should do, check out this talk with Alan and Frederick. It's it's educational. It's informative. It's entertainment as well. So check out this talk for higher level SBOM information. So a lot of the reason why we're talking about SBOM, folks like Jeff and Josh Corman and many others have been advocating for SBOMs for a decade, maybe a little bit more. Sorry to show your age there, Jeff. But it's really been driven home with the executive order here in the US. And that EO, the link here, lists out the minimum elements for the SBOM. Now, these are the minimum things. Now, Jeff talked a little bit about not all SBOMs are created equal. And I completely agree, because these minimum elements are not overly beneficial. These minimum elements are going to give you the minimum required for basic vulnerability management use cases. That's it. Really, really basic stuff. So minimum fields equals minimum benefit. But what else should you care about? Well, turns out there's a lot of things that we should all care about. Authenticity being one of them, right? If I'm building software and I'm shipping software and I am including a bunch of other components in my SBOM, I should be able to sign that particular component. So authenticity. Can I verify the integrity of the software components that I'm using? Hashes are certainly one way to do that, so they should be included. Jeff hit on this earlier in his talk. Services. Software doesn't live in a bubble. It hasn't lived in a bubble for 20 years. Yet the minimum fields don't mention anything about services. As a consumer, consumer services are just as important as the software itself. So they should absolutely be included. In many, many cases, however, especially if you have an application that's tightly coupled, you might not necessarily be able to upgrade those components, right? So you might instead backport remediation. So yes, I'm using a vulnerable version of, I don't know, Angular 1.6, but you know what? I've actually backported these half a dozen fixes so that my version of 1.6 isn't actually vulnerable. So how do you communicate that outwards? Is the application or is the components themselves, do they have any security advisors, right? Am I using vulnerable version of Red Hat or Debian or whatever else? And what are the security advisories for that thing that I'm using? In a lot of cases, I might want to disclose any either known vulnerabilities or unknown vulnerabilities about the components that I'm using or the application as a whole. How complete is the SBOM? You know, as Jeff mentioned, this is kind of hard. And depending on the method in which you create the SBOM, its completeness or accuracy is going to vary. So how complete is it? How confident are you in that completeness? That should be included. Where did you get something from? It's a really basic question. Did you get it from Maven Central? Did you get it from a certain supplier? Did you get it from a certain country, right? So provenance is really about the origin story. And if I've modified components, right, what is the DNA that made it up? What does that pedigree look like? Parts of an SBOM. And of course, not everything revolves around security. There are other use cases like license use cases as well. So there's a lot of other things that should ideally be in your SBOM. So how do you create SBOMs? Well, there's a lot of different ways to create them, right? Creating SBOMs can be very, very easy, and or you can make it into a really complex process. But we're going to go through a couple of different ways to kind of create SBOMs. The easy button in a lot of cases is going to be your SCA tool. SCA, software composition analysis, is Gardner, Forrester recommended thing. And a lot of organizations use SCA tools of either open source tools, commercial tools. Many open source or many SCA vendors support SBOMs. If they do not support CycloneDX, for example, most I think do, but if your vendor doesn't support it for whatever reason, demand that they do. The security industry, for the most part, has already adopted it. But this is one way to produce SBOMs. But SCA tools were never designed to identify accurate inventory. They were designed to identify risk. Two completely different problems, which kind of leads into a different way to create an SBOM with your build lifecycle. For example, a Maven plugin or an NPM plugin or a Webpack plugin. Integrating it into the build lifecycle, typically lifecycles will resolve dependencies throughout the phases of that lifecycle. If you look at it through without that lifecycle integration, you can get results. Will they be accurate? Maybe, maybe not. But you are much more, you can get much more accurate results as being part of that lifecycle itself. You can also just point it to a directory on a file system or a Git repo, right? You can create source SBOMs, not overly useful for a lot of security use cases. There are a few, but most security use cases, this isn't overly useful. It's very useful, however, for license and intellectual property use cases. Dynamic runtime. Jeff walked us through some of the important aspects of why creating SBOMs dynamically at runtime is a good idea. This is actually kind of growing on me over the last 6 months, where I've actually seen a couple of different ways to create these things dynamically. It's really, really interesting, especially given the fact that you can also incorporate services. I don't know about you, but the POM or the package.json, I can't describe services in these things, right? I'm kind of blind to the use of these things. However, if I can do it dynamically at runtime, I get a lot more visibility. I can integrate SBOM or generate SBOMs at the factory level itself. So if I'm using Jenkins, all Jenkins jobs get an SBOM, or all GitHub Actions get an SBOM. Will they be accurate? Maybe, maybe not, because your factory integration isn't necessarily part of your build lifecycle integration. Two entirely different things, but this is a really easy way to get thousands of SBOMs across all of your builds without a lot of effort. And finally, not all ecosystems use package managers. Package managers make things easy. Runtime platforms make things easy, but there's still some ecosystems, C and C++, that are stuck with practices dating back 30, 40 years. So manual dependency management, manual modification of components, and manual SBOM creation is going to have to be the reality for a lot of those folks. So I wanted to mention all this because there's a lot of different ways to create SBOMs. And depending on the application and the language ecosystem, et cetera, business drivers, There's going to be a lot of different ways to create that. So pick the best approach for a certain scenario, because you don't want to be this guy. Again, trying to reiterate what Jeff was talking about, not all SBOMs are created equal. So garbage in one approach, for example, if you have a use case that you want to use that SBOM for, make sure that you're using make sure you have the fields that it's going to support that use case, and make sure you are generating that SBOM that will provide you that data so that when you get to that use case that you want to use the SBOMs for, that you can actually do it successfully. Because if you don't, you're going to have garbage in and garbage out, and you don't want to do that. You want to avoid that if possible. So now that we talk a little bit about SBOMs and a lot of different ways to create them, what's CycloneDX? Well, there we go. So at a very, very high level, this is kind of the object model of what CycloneDX actually is. First of all, it's not a software bill of materials format. It's actually a bill of materials format. Software just being one of these things. Because I can describe applications and frameworks and operating systems. I can describe devices. I can describe other things as well. I can describe services and their dependency relationships. I can describe how complete certain parts or the SBOM as a whole actually is. I can describe the vulnerabilities against all of these components and services as they relate to the application that my SBOM describes. And I can optionally describe the exploitability of those components and services within the context of my running application. And finally, CycloneDX is extensible. There's a number of different ways to put data into CycloneDX that isn't native to the core specification. But like I said, CycloneDX is not an SBOM format. It's a bill of materials format, and SBOM is one of many capabilities. So we all are familiar with software bill of materials because we've been talking about it for the last hour. But we have OBOMs, or operational bill of materials, which describes something in operation. It could include the application, it could include the operating system and device drivers, and potentially even the hardware that it's running on. Deployment, teams of responsibility, et cetera. There's a lot of other types of information that can go into an OBOM. In fact, OBOM is actually a BSIM behavior. So operational bill of materials is a BSIM behavior. Manufacturing bill of materials. There are IoT toasters, there are vending machines, there are other kinds of devices that have software. And you can describe that full stack. When I describe full stack, I mean hardware, everything, all the way up through the application to the library. So you can describe that full stack, including a lot of the GS1 fields that would describe, for example, UPC codes for physical devices. But as, again, Jeff was alluding to, you can describe services. But what if I had a bill of material that was only services, right? What if I wanted to describe my entire microservice architecture? Yeah, you can do that too. In fact, you can describe, for example, if you had, 20 different microservices, you could describe each 20 of those services in your bill of materials, and then each service could then link out to its corresponding SBOM. So you get this full picture of all of your services and how they relate to one another, their dependency relationships, as well as the software that powers each one of those services. So you get a more holistic view of reality. And finally, vulnerability exploitability exchange, or VEX. Not all third-party components are going to be vulnerable or exploitable. So being able to communicate that out so that consumers of software can make better risk-based decisions is crucial to the success of SBOM. So CycloneDX is, it's an OWASP project, but it's been in use for a while now. Its primary objective is cybersecurity use cases, and it's in production at an estimated 100,000 organizations. This is a page that has a lot of the use cases that you can achieve with CycloneDX. So if you're interested in some of these more advanced use cases other than just, hey, what is my inventory? Check out this page, give you a better picture of other types of analysis, other types of data that would be required for that type of analysis. And then finally, the CycloneDX Tool Center. As Jeff was mentioning earlier, you know, it's not the only format, but we have a really, really rich ecosystem of tools, both produced by the OWASP community as well as produced by others. We currently have in excess of 110 tools, I think, 110, 11, something like that, tools that are available. So it's a fairly mature ecosystem of both, OWASP, CycloneDX folks creating tools, as well as a whole community of other folks creating tools. Here's some resources on CycloneDX. One thing to note on this, because a lot of us are going to be OWASP folks, is that CycloneDX has its own dedicated Slack workspace, independent of the OWASP Slack workspace. This is for historical purposes, because originally CycloneDX was not an OWASP project, but it has been for, I don't know, a year. But we also have in excess of 20 channels. So it's not a single channel that you would expect in the OWASP Slack workspace. We actually have channels for all the different implementations, as well as the specification and a few other things as well. So there's a lot of channels in our Slack workspace. So if you're interested in this type of topic, then check out our Slack as well. But what do you do once you have an SBOM, right? Now, I have an SBOM, now what, right? We talked about a database, that's a start. So let's talk about what we're going to do with the SBOM. How do we operationalize the SBOM now that I have one? So what does dependency track do? Well, it consumes, it analyzes, and produces SBOMs at high velocity. That's interesting. Which means it's ideal for use in modern build pipelines. But it's also ideal for procurement and M&A. And we'll actually go through a manual use case just to kind of show the steps that would be involved for procurement, for example. But I like to show this one manual use case in a demo. Automation is easy, but it's at some point it seems like magic. But I want to actually kind of walk you through the actual steps. So dependency track is really designed to answer one question: what is affected, log4j, and where? Acme application 1.0. Conceptually, this is what it does. So I have an asset, could be a microservice, could be an IoT toaster, whatever the case is. I have an asset, I have a bill of material for that asset, and I continuously analyze it, right? And everybody's happy. Going down a little bit further, this is really what happens. So over on the left, I produce SBOMs, or I acquire them from my vendors. Second step, I ingest them. I consume them in dependency track. And once dependency track consumes them, it analyzes them, right? An SBOM is your inventory of stuff along with a bunch of other data. Great, now I can analyze that. But it doesn't just analyze it that one time, right? It continuously analyzes it, I think either 12 or 24 hours, something like that. But all that data in dependency track it's useful, but it isn't overly useful if it's only in dependency track. So we have webhooks and a bunch of other ways to stream that data to external sources so that you as an organization can make better risk-based decisions. For example, if I've got a new vulnerability that was introduced in an application, maybe I want to automatically create a Jira ticket, or maybe I want to, you know, do some other kind of action. So there's enough information in our streams that we provide that you can react in an automated way in a lot of cases. So yeah, let's pray to the demo gods and see what's gonna happen here. Let's see, let me share my other screen. Share screen. There we go. Okay, so this is the very first thing that when you log into the Dependency Track for the first time, this is what you see. Now, Dependency Track supports its own internal user management. It supports LDAP, it supports OAuth. So most enterprises should be able to integrate with this quite easily. But this is basically what you'll see. You'll see a nice, pretty dashboard with a bunch of pretty colors, kind of telling you, you know, where your at a really high level, where your risk actually is. But I wanna go to my project. So in Dependency Track, everything is a project. A project could be a piece of software, could be a mobile app, microservice, could be the IoT toaster, right? It's a collection of inventory, essentially, is a project. And I've got about 7 projects here defined, but I wanna go ahead and create a new one. Right. And everything that I'm doing in the user interface here, you can do over API and then some. In fact, it has an API first design. The API has a lot more functionality than the UI has. So everything that I'm doing in the UI, you can automate to your heart's content. But let's see, Jeff, you created WebGoat, right? So let's create an application for WebGoat, and let's give it some tags, maybe OWASP and vulnerable by design. Okay. Okay, so now I have my WebGoat application. Yay, I have no risk. I can go home now. Fantastic. But no, in seriousness, I want to upload my bill of material. And again, in a normal DevOps CIC pipeline, this would be part of your job, right? This would be part of your Jenkins job, your Circle CI, GitHub Actions, whatever. I'm going to show you a manual use case. So I'm going to upload my bill of material. Let me find it. So I've got a bill of material for WebGoat already prepared. I'm going to upload it. And that's really about it. So I'm just going to refresh here so everything comes back. And my inventory here, I've got 136 components in my inventory. And let's just kind of go through here. So I've got the component, the name of the component, the version of that component. And if it has a group identifier, then not all equal systems obviously have groups. But if it has one, Java, Maven, and NPM optionally does. But your coordinates are here, license, if it has any risk. Let's actually do a sort on this. Let's see, oh, nothing's been analyzed yet. Okay, we'll wait. But we can also go to, well, let's actually check for something. Let's look for log4j. Okay, and it looks like I'm only using it over SLF4j, so that's not entirely bad. Let's look for something else, maybe, does it have H2? No. Jackson Databind. Oh, yeah. So it does have Jackson Databind, and I can see here that, yeah, it has a lot of vulnerabilities in there. So I can go into Jackson Databind, and I can get information about the component, right? It's a library. Looks like the license didn't pick up. I got all the hash values, some external references, etc. And then, of course, I can get to all the vulnerabilities, right? So these are all the vulnerabilities that that it was able to pick up. Looks like I picked up a bunch of GitHub security advisories. Anything else that it picked up? No, looks like about it. Okay. Oh, let me go back to WebGoat. What am I doing? Okay. But you can also view like the dependency graph, right? So WebGoat was my application. I can expand that. and I can just keep on going out, right? So I can get my full dependency graph with this view. We're going to be making some other views as well. So there's a lot of things that we can do with the dependency graph that we're going to be working on over the next 6 to 8 months or so. So expect some different views for the dependency graph coming up. But as Jeff was mentioning, not every component is going to be exploitable, right? There's a difference between having a vulnerable component in an application and that component being exploitable within the context of that application. So we have essentially what equates to as an auditing framework. If you're used to things like Fortify, this is going to feel very, very familiar to you. So we can go into a component, for example, and we get a kind of a synopsis of what the issue is, but we can make analysis decisions on the use of this component. So for example, if this thing is not vulnerable because of some reason, then I can actually, you know, make that kind of comment. I can set the analysis to maybe, not affected, right? A reason why I'm not affected, maybe the code is not reachable, right? I'm not actually using that part of that component. And I am not going to fix it, right? As a vendor, that is my prerogative to choose not to fix something. And so you have the ability to then communicate that out, just not only to yourselves as a software development shop, but if you were a software vendor, this becomes part of what you can optionally communicate out to your customers as well, or VEX. So I'll show you VEX in just a bit. But anyway, you've got this whole auditing framework. Theoretically, we might have to play around with this, Jeff, but theoretically, if I've got some runtime stuff and I've got all APIs over in dependency track, I should be able to kind of mirror this stuff up so that if something is not reachable, for example, it could be automatically done in dependency track, which would be really interesting. If I had any policy violations, they would be flagged here. Dependency track does have a policy engine. I'll go over that in a bit. And if I had any services, they would be here as well. Let me actually show you one of the services though. I have a example down here. It has a single component for simplicity's purposes. It has a single component called stock Java client. So this component is a simple wrapper around getting stock quotes from the internet. But guess what? It doesn't actually have any functionality of its own, right? It's a convenience library at best. It actually relies on this service right here. So this is also in my inventory. And it tells me what it is, who the provider of that service is. Give me some URLs, some endpoints. What are the data classifications and the directional flow of data? And are there any external references for this service? And all of this information is actually or can be in your SBOM, right? It's part of your inventory. It's part of that bill of materials. So if you have a bunch of these things that are by default part of your application, when maybe a customer installs them, you can actually include these services in your inventory. That way, when they consume the SBOM with tools like Dependency Track, they'll get much clearer, holistic inventory of everything that you're providing by default. There is a desire, if you're kind of going to that next step and asking, huh, I wonder how OWASP Zap could integrate with this, then you are kind of reading my thoughts. I think there's some potential integrations that we can do with some different OWASP tools, Zap being one of them, because now that I have my endpoints, great, let's scan them. So I think there's some other things that we can do here. Steve, is a question, is dependency track being used at ServiceNow? Yes and no. ServiceNow is very, very complex. And we, most security tools don't work out of the box for us. And we have to either write our own security tools or we have to customize the things that we use to the nth degree. So it is being used, but in a limited capacity at the moment. I think it's going to be more and more used actually for procurement. So we'll see what that happens, if that happens. But let me go to one of the examples that we kind of introduced that concept of what is affected and where, right? So let me kind of go to it from a different perspective, right? Maybe instead of going from a project perspective, maybe I want to search for Log4j, right? Why didn't that come up? Coordinates. Okay, there we go. So this tells me, for example, all the applications that have Log4j, and I can get very specific with this, but imagine an enterprise that has tens of thousands of applications in their environment. Being able to know where a vulnerable version of Log4j is kind of important, because you have to know what systems that you might need to patch first before, you know, looking at anything else. So this kind of tells you where in your environment certain components are actually being used. But you can also do some other things, right? So this is the coordinates. You can do that. You can search by package URL, which is a standardized way to represent component identity, no matter what ecosystem it's part of. So this is the preferred way of doing things. But you can also search for CPE, or common platform enumeration. You can search for SWID tag IDs, right? So this is a different way of identifying software. SWID is an ISO standard. It's primarily used to identify commercial software, mostly for entitlements. But if you want to know where, you know, certain commercial software is used in your environment, this would be one way to do it. You can also search on hash, and this is an interesting use case as well. So for example, if you have a known malicious version of some library that you know you are using in your environment, but you don't know where, but you know the hash of that malicious thing, you can search across your entire environment for the existence of this thing, assuming you have bill of materials for all of your assets. So this is a really good way to identify where in your environment that you might need to look and mitigate certain risk. You can also come to it from a different perspective, right? Maybe you're reading the news and you see, CVE, I think this is the one. Okay, yeah, this is the one. So this, I think, is a Log4j vulnerability, I think. So yeah, say you're watching the news or whatever, and you hear about this, you know, vulnerability. Well, you can come to it from this perspective as well. So in this case, it tells me one project in my entire environment is actually using this thing, right? So I know that KeyCloak, an old version of KeyCloak that I have, is affected by this particular vulnerability. So you can come to this data from a lot of different perspectives, which is really useful. It does support licenses, right? Again, security is not the only use case in the world. Licenses are supported. We do have some limited license support. It does work. If your primary concern is intellectual property and license, though, Dependency Track probably isn't the right tool for that. We will be expanding its support for licenses and intellectual property in future versions. But quite honestly, there's so many other cybersecurity use cases that are more important at the moment that we're going to be focusing on those first. Some of those cybersecurity use cases revolve around policy. And CycloneDX has a fairly decent policy engine as well. Out of the box, it has a bunch of different license groups. This is not like the license groups from commercial vendors, right? We can't use commercial data, We have to use data that is freely and publicly available. So, but we do out of the box provide four different license groups with different licenses in each one of these groups. So you are free to add your own groups, create new groups, etc. But the idea here is that if you want to, for example, prohibit any kind of copyleft license in your environment, that would be one use case that you could do. You can create policies. For example, I might want to create a policy for prohibited components, and I might want to fail on that. And say, for example, I wanted to fail on anything that had struts, right? That would be a policy. So for example, if my organization is allergic to Apache struts, this would be one way to do that. So anytime I would ingest and consume a bill of materials, that policy violation would then be triggered. If that BOM was part of a CI/CD pipeline, then I could potentially even have my pipeline either fail or go into a warning state upon analysis of that. So there's a lot of different things that you can do with the policy evaluation support. Let's see, did I cover everything? I think I did, but I do want to go into kind of how dependency track works at a high level. There's a bunch of different analyzers that dependency track includes. It has an internal analyzer that works with the NVD or CPE data. That internal analyzer also works with GitHub security advisors. We have a dedicated analyzer for Sonatype OSS Index. That's a free service. It's pretty good though. A lot of dependency track users use this by default. If you have a subscription to VulnDB from risk-based security, we support that as well. You can optionally change your mirroring of the NVD, right? There's an entire mirror of the NVD that we have within dependency track. You can change that if you want. There's a lot of organizations that have internal mirrors of the NVD, especially in different countries throughout the world. You can also set up your GitHub advisory support. For whatever reason, you could only get GitHub advisories through their GraphQL API, which requires authentication. So in order for GitHub advisories to be effective, you actually have to enter your token for that. We support a number of different repositories. So dependency track will identify if a component is out of date or not. And these are all the different repository types that we support, and they're all configurable, for example. So out of the box, this is kind of what you get for Maven, for example. But if you have your own internal repositories, well, you can configure those as well. We have a lot of notifications. You can create notifications on different things. We support We support a lot of different ways to get notified on different things, as well as different ways to get authenticated, right? WebEx, Teams, Slack, webhooks, you know, whatever. So there's a lot of different ways that you can get notified on certain types of events. We do integrate with Fortify Software Security Center, Defect Dojo, as well as Kenna Security as well out of the box. So there's nothing really that you have to do other than just configuring it. There's really nothing else that you have to do. And then finally, like I said, we support LDAP, OIDC, et cetera. So with that, so I think there was a couple questions. CycloneDX is an SBOM, is a format similar like SBOM. So CycloneDX is the SBOM format, right? It is the bill of materials format. CycloneDX is available in JSON. It's available as XML as well as protocol buffers. So we do not view SBOM as a document. I think a document is a legacy 1980s type of way of looking at inventory. We live in a DevOps first world, and the SBOM is, or the bill of materials, I view it as more of a as a messaging format, right? Messaging between systems. And yes, you can serialize XML and JSON. Protocol buffers is a lot more efficient. So if you have tens of thousands of SBOMs per day or more, protocol buffers is probably a good is a good choice. Is dependency track tool part of CycloneDX? If not, where can I buy the software? Both of these things are open source tools. They are both flagship OWASP projects. Yeah, I have a day job, and you know, I don't know if anyone in the audience has created a flagship project before or an open source project to begin with. It's a lot of effort, especially a lot of effort to get hundreds of thousands of organizations actually using your stuff. Once you get to flagship, it's kind of a big deal. And I don't know if I'm an overachiever or what, because now I've got two flagship projects. But I'm not the only one, right? Jim Monaco and many, many others have multiple flagships as well. But these are completely independent projects, though. Dependency Track is a tool that consumes and analyzes software bill of materials. Its format of choice is CycloneDX, specifically because CycloneDX is for security use cases. CycloneDX is another flagship OWASP project. It is a standards-based project. The interesting thing about CycloneDX is that it's probably unlike most OWASP projects you're familiar with. It kind of operates as its own foundation of sorts without having the legal entity of such. We have our own working groups. We have our own standardization process. We have our own voting process. It operates as a meritocracy, very similar to the Apache Foundation. So it's a very, very different kind of OWASP project, but it is an OWASP project. And it's completely independent from Dependency Track by design. If we want SBOMs to be successful and widely used and whatnot, it cannot be tied to a specific tool. It needs to be simple so that people can very easily adopt it. People can very easily write tools to understand and communicate the bill of materials. So it needs to be easily adoptable. It needs to be a really rich ecosystem of tools that support it. So it's a completely independent project. Let's see, what other questions? I think that's all. I think I'm caught up. All right, so with that, let me stop sharing here and reshare my deck. I'm almost done with the deck. Boom. And I think the demo gods were actually good to me. So with that, here are some links for Dependency Track. The website, as well as our GitHub. We do use the OWASP Slack workspace. We have the Dependency Track project channel that everyone is welcome to use. And then there's our Twitter feed as well. So with that, thank you. I wish I was there in person, but you know, if there's any other questions, whatnot, if Jeff's still around, maybe we can, do a little Q&A.
Thank you very much, Steve, for an amazing talk and live demo. I think live demo is very important, and luckily demo gods were nice to you, and it's great to see the tool in action. And I think the fact that you the search facility and the functionality of the tool, of course, is amazing. There was a question that I was trying to put on the screen. Let me put it back, which is basically a question. Well, a bit of a generic one. Can you answer this? Why none of the tools find out log for J vulnerabilities? Like, what is your idea recommendation going forward to find out early in the SSLDC lifecycle?
Yeah, so I would recommend, there's a lot of different ways that you can get at SBOM, right? And there's a lot of different ways that you can identify vulnerabilities in third-party components. I'm a big advocate of build time, bill of materials. So actually producing them as just another artifact of your build process. Mm-hmm. So if you're a modern development shop, produce an SBOM for it. It's fairly easy to do. In fact, if it takes you more than 10 minutes, I would reach out to the community because it is really that simple. I would do that, right? So, you know, use SCA tools. They are great. Use AST tools. They're fine. Use runtime tools. However you get to it, I think is the important part. But just use a lot of best practices. And one of the best practices is knowing what software is in your stuff. Looking at your package.json or your Maven POM, for example, is not going to give you the inventory. It's going to give you the desire for inventory. What you actually get is usually something completely different. So knowing what's in your stuff is a foundational requirement of many different frameworks. One such framework is the OWASP Software Component Verification Standard. It's a way for organizations to kind of measure and improve their software supply chain assurance. And SBOM is a foundational level one behavior, right? You have to know what's in your stuff, because once you know what's in your stuff, then you can start analyzing the stuff for known vulnerabilities. Analyzing for known, yeah.
Hey, I just want to jump in. I think this question is about finding the Log4j vulnerability before it became known, right?
Mm-hmm. Like,
so it's a little bit different. So everything Steve's talking about is great once someone finds the vulnerability and it becomes a known vulnerability, and then great, we can track it, we can update it and all that. But this question is really like, hey, why are we not finding more of these open source vulnerabilities earlier on in the process? And it's a completely different problem, right? So this one in particular is a relatively complex injection flaw. Data comes in from the user, it goes through a log message, like the developer has to log something untrusted, and then that untrusted data goes through into the library, Log4j interprets it as a template, and through the evaluation of that template, it calls a JNDI query. The JNDI query can be tricked into returning a malicious payload from a remote source, and then that remote source can itself exploit an expression language injection flaw or an unsafe initialization flaw to cause remote code execution. So sorry for that complex description, but it is a complex flaw that old school tools like static analysis tools and dynamic scanners are very unlikely to find. And you got to remember, nobody is really out there looking at open source components. There's a handful of volunteer security researchers that dedicate their free time to analyzing stuff and finding flaws. And then those become these known vulnerabilities that there's an entire ecosystem built on top of, but it's all balanced on the top of this really narrow upside down pyramid with a handful of people doing this as a volunteer hobby. So literally a whole market is built on the work of these volunteer researchers. And what that tells me is that there are zillions of open source vulnerabilities out there that are undiscovered, latent vulnerabilities. And you can see it with Log4j. As soon as someone discovered the first Log4j vulnerability, within the next few days, there were three or four more critical vulnerabilities that got discovered because people were like, oh crap, let's look at it. And finally, we started finding some things. But it's not like all the open source code is really analyzed very well. And look, I actually believe that open source code is generally more secure than enterprise code. I've looked at an awful lot of code over the years, manually code reviewing the code and pen testing it. And in general, open source code is higher quality with less vulnerabilities. However, there's a lot of vulnerability out there. And this is the challenge that we face as OWASP is, how do we raise the bar across entire world of software that's built that's full of vulnerabilities. So, you know, SBOM's like one little step towards improving the ecosystem and making the market more aware, but it's like the first of like at least 20 steps that have to happen. Think of like the automobile industry, when in the US we used to build cars that were very dangerous to drive. And over the last 40 years, that's gotten a lot better, but it's been a lot of little steps, from crash testing, government standards, window stickers, you know, a whole bunch of things have happened, including market competition, which somebody mentioned during my talk, in order to get to a market where most cars are pretty safe now. And that's what has to happen in the software industry. But we're in the Stone Age. So if you're out there, if you're getting into AppSec, you know, great, listen to dinosaurs like me and Steve. But there is a fantastic career ahead of you as the world adjusts to a world of secure software, as opposed to a world of software that we just got out the door really fast.
This is so true. And it also kind of underscores the need for mitigating vulnerable components really, really quickly, because that known vulnerabilities, that's just known by the majority of folks. Your nation state adversaries probably already know about a lot of these things well in advance. So there's adversaries already looking at all this code and choosing not to disclose, because you know it's an advantage for their adversarial efforts. So it's really, really important that once these new vulnerabilities are finally known to the rest of us, time to remediate is really, really important.
Yeah, I totally agree. I strongly recommend that you use runtime protection on your applications and APIs. Many runtime protection vendors, some of them didn't protect against Log4j. Some of them did. Contrast did, for instance. And our customers that were using our Protect product, they got to go home for the weekend because they were safe. They could fix these libraries at you know, a leisurely, non-fire drill kind of way, which is the way security should work. But what runtime protection does is it makes whole classes of vulnerability more difficult to exploit. So things like SQL injection and XXE and SSRF and cross-site scripting and expression language injection and unsafe deserialization, all these problems are much more difficult to exploit. I'm never going to say impossible, because that's a big word, but way more difficult. And so it's really worth the juice is worth the squeeze to put runtime protection on your applications and APIs.
Yeah, totally agree. And Jeff, since you mentioned exploitability, Steve, you only touched up on the VEX vulnerability exchange. Can you please talk a bit more about VEX and how it is implemented in Dependency Track and what it will help users to achieve?
Yeah, absolutely. In fact, I think I might have glossed that over in my demo, but just where you can, just where you upload the bill of materials, you can also download the bill of materials, including the VEX. So if I am a software vendor, for example, I can actually produce the VEX for my customers. And that's kind of important, because I can then say, here, Mr. Customer, this is my bill of material for the thing that I'm giving you. And yes, I am including these vulnerable components in my inventory. And no, I'm not actually vulnerable to these things, so don't bug me. So that's a way to describe why something is not vulnerable. Because if I'm a customer, right, if I'm the consumer, I need to make risk-based decisions, and I don't want to necessarily go down chasing all of my vendors to fix things that aren't necessarily exploitable, right? I care about the exploitable things that have a direct impact to my organization. So VEX is a way to communicate that something is or is not important.
Yeah, I think it's a very, very important thing, because with Log4j, I think what we've seen is, I think every single organization contacting their vendors and suppliers and saying, can you please give us a statement whether you have Log4j in the software and whether you are vulnerable to Log4Shell vulnerability? And obviously having something like a VEX is actually a way to publish that information to everyone rather than answering hundreds and hundreds of emails and letters requesting that information.
Yeah, Jeff brought up the fact that there's going to be some pushback by some vendors. And some vendors just don't want to be transparent, but other vendors see it as a support issue, right? If I produce an SBOM and make it available to all my customers, my support cost is going to go through the roof. And without a VEX, that actually could be true. So VEX is a way for those vendors to actually greatly reduce their support costs for actually producing the SBOM and delivering those out to their customers.
Hey, Steve, I had a question for you. How do you think about, you know, the end state? Like, let's say we start generating SBOMs, we're managing our components and all the vulnerabilities, and we get to a point where we're clean. So it's a hypothetical, so like, work with me. But, you know, that really should be the end state, right? And so how do you encourage folks to work off their backlog and get to that healthy state? Because I think the amount of work goes down dramatically. Like, there's two phases of it, right? Like, there's the initial state where you get healthy, and then there's like a steady state after that where it's like, hey, let's just upgrade libraries proactively to keep so we're close. And, you know, we as a culture, we just stay up to date. And I'm just wondering if the tooling changes between those two states. Like, if you're just keeping up to date, who cares about prioritization? Like, it's just, you know, it's part of your culture. You're just going to upgrade it anyway. So I'm just curious how you think about that.
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, I would love to see some automated governance around software supply chain assurance. I think that's kind of where we need to go. But I also think we need a way of identifying certain attributes on various open source projects. And I'll give you a really good example. The H2 embedded database library is a very, very popular Java embedded database. And that project, I mean, it's used by millions of people. And they do not backport security fixes, right? They don't. So you have to use the latest version. Yep. And unfortunately, the latest version has breaking changes. So organizations, millions of organizations, now have a choice. They can use a vulnerable version of H2 and risk the potential exploit of that library, or they can upgrade to the latest and their application will break. If I'm an organization, I'm going to choose the vulnerable component. Right? It's less risky to me. Having an application that breaks, you know, that doesn't do me any good. So I think we need a way to identify different attributes of these different projects so that we can make better risk-based decisions while we're choosing what components we want to pull into our libraries in the first place.
Yeah. I totally agree. There's not a lot of information available for developers to choose open source projects based on, right? It's like, how nice does the website look? you'd think you'd make decisions based on, like, you know, is it being maintained? What are their policies around security bugs and back patching and so on? But that's not how it happens.
No, not at all. You know, there's just a lot of different, there's so much power that, I mean, if you think about a developer, they get to choose for the most part, you know, what third party parties are kind of running at the same privilege as their first party code. That's an enormous amount of power without a lot of responsibility also on the developers to make good decisions. If I'm an enterprise and if I want to procure software, I go through a rigorous vendor risk management process. I'm sure Contrast has been through many of these. You know what I'm talking about.
Every week, multiple.
Exactly. No kidding. A developer can choose what random, you know, code that they're going to run at the same privilege as their own. That's an enormous amount of power. And
it's really interesting. Sorry, I'll finish your point.
No, I would just love to see some kind of automated way to bring this kind of issue to light, because it's one of these scenarios, I think, where people just accept it as normal, but it's not actually normal, or at least it shouldn't be.
Yeah, I totally agree. And you know, the original mandate of the Java security manager was to handle that kind of problem. You used to run applets in your browser and you didn't want to give the applet the full privilege of the browser. So there's sandbox, and you can use that sandbox really narrowly to carve out permissions for different libraries and namespaces. It is a performance hit though. And so people don't use the Java Security Manager on the server side, never have. A couple of customers I've seen have tried, but they don't do it. And it is changing in the serverless environment. Interestingly, serverless functions, you can grant them permissions to do certain things, like this can access an S3 bucket, this can talk to a queue, and so on. And by breaking your code down into serverless functions and then managing the IAM permissions that you give to each function, you can actually accomplish what you're talking about. Maybe the future is more granular access control, but then every time we do this, every time we create a complex policy language to enforce that kind of thing, people don't use it because it's too complicated. And so, I mean, we've seen it over and over, from firewall rules to mandatory access control to, IAM permissions and the Java sandbox. Like, it's always the same problem. Nobody configures policy at the level they would need in order to actually control stuff. So we end up chasing vulnerabilities around all day.
Yeah, exactly. And whack-a-mole is not a strategy, right? It's what you do when you don't have one. So I think as an
good if there's not a lot of moles,
right?
That's actually my strategy for my line. We don't have every once in a while we get a mole, and like I go, I don't whack it, but I try and get rid of it. But like, it doesn't work if you've got hundreds of apps and thousands of vulnerabilities and a giant backlog, and you'll never get so you can't manage that mess.
No. In terms of like SBOM and stuff, I think this is probably an intermediary step. I think we're at a stepping stone, essentially. I would love to see all of your build tools, all of your compile tools, just everything, just support it, just natively, so that as a developer, I don't have to opt in to doing this, right? I should just, by using my tools, this should just be a natural artifact of developing software. So bill of materials, all the manifest about that bill of materials. And I envision this more of as a tool-to-tool communication thing in the future. I don't know if that's ever going to pan out, but that's what I would hope for, right? Anything with security where you have to opt in is always much, much harder than opting out, right? So you're going to make a lot more progress if this was like enabled by default for everybody.
Yeah, I think there's a comment from Vinod about security scorecards and security health metrics for open source. Touched up on labeling as well, right?
Yeah. It's all about transparency. We're in the early, early stages of transparency. And I think it's going to be really important. There are going to be some first movers that really get transparent, and I think it will be to their advantage in the market.
True. So thank you very much, Steve and Jeff, for amazing talks and amazing discussion about software supply chain security, transparency, where we are. Jeff, you're saying we're still in a dinosaur stage, but hopefully with some of the open source tools that OWASP provides, and of course you guys lead these projects, and we as a community, and I think the enterprise world, is eternally thankful to you for your volunteer efforts in providing these projects to everyone. And I'd like to remind everyone that both JBOM and Dependency Track are absolutely free and open source projects that are available to just go and download on GitHub and start using them straight away. would like to thank speakers once again, and we'd like to remind everyone that if you'd like to follow OWASP London chapter, you can do it by visiting our webpage on Twitter, we're OWASP London. You can also like us on Facebook. We're also on Slack as Chapter London. Also on Meetup. Of course, you're watching us on YouTube. Please do subscribe to our channel so you don't miss our next live streams. And we're also on LinkedIn, where you can follow our organization as OWASP London. I'd like to say a big thank you to all our chapter supporters, and of course also to Contrast, who provided us with a set of Bose headphones. And if you would like to enter the prize draw, please follow this URL to enter the prize draw, and it will close at midnight on Sunday 13th of March, and the winner will get a not just a set of the headphones, but also a merchandise pack from Contrast Security. So would like to thank our sponsor for this. And I'd like to thank everyone and remind everyone the recordings of talks will be available on OWASP London YouTube channel. And the slides of the talks you watch tonight will also be shared on our webpage under past events under owasp.org/London. Thanks, everyone. Thank you very much, our speakers, and stay safe. Thank you, and bye-bye.